Okay, so cricket balls off this Thursday edition of the SportsMax Zone. Fans, analysts and those interested in West Indies cricket have all sounded their voices in reaction to news that Cricket West Indies will have a new chief executive officer after Johnny Grave leaves the post in the final quarter of this year. News broke on Monday that Grave will leave office when his contract expires in October after 7 years in the role. The Englishman oversaw three World Cups hosted in this region, along with captaining the ship of cricket's restart post the COVID-19 pandemic. Grave joins us live on Zoom. Johnny Grave, welcome to the SportsMax Zone. Great to have you on the show again today, although the feeling is a little different today from our previous interactions with you, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, good evening. Yeah, it's always a pleasure to come on, so I hope you're all well.
Yeah, all right, let me start here, because last year, your contract was extended for 1 year to allow your overseeing of the ICC T20 World Cup. Did that mean at that point that you were already aware or already planning not to be in the role beyond late 2024?
Yeah, look, I guess every contract that I've had here, there's been a clear objective. When I first came, it was around improving the player relations and trying to sort of build the commercial revenues of the board. Obviously, fairly quickly into the second contract, COVID came, and that was more than anything really about survival. And when that ended, we'd won this extraordinary opportunity to host this T20 World Cup and co-host it with the US, and the mission was very much to deliver that, which has obviously now happened. So, I've been in discussions with the president about when was the right time to move on, and certainly didn't want to outstay my welcome here in the role. And I'm very conscious it's a role that's hugely demanding and requires lots and lots of energy. And I was definitely feeling it after, the 7.5 years, and particularly the last 12 months of dealing with the World Cup too, and a family that came here when my kids were just 4 and 6, and now they're moving into their teenage years. It was always about transition and moving on. And yeah, the board has decided that they're happy for me to hand over to an interim CEO on the 31st of October. So that brings to the end my adventure and my time at Cricket West Indies.
Yeah, Johnny, the report card that has been written for you from most experts suggests that people are satisfied with the job that you did. I listened a bit of the Andrew Mason show on Voice of Barbados Radio on Tuesday, and the comments were generally favorable in assessing your performance as a CEO. And I saw some very glowing reports, too, from Dinanath Ramnarayan, the former CEO and president of WIPA, who usually is very caustic and doesn't have many kind words for many people, but he had very kind words for you, sir. How do you assess your performance in the 7+ years that you've held this role?
Look, I haven't had much time to reflect on it, if I'm honest. I think, firstly, it was always, as I said, a huge honour and privilege and a massive responsibility to lead the organisation. I've been so supported by the staff in particular, but the players, which was obviously the biggest challenge that I had when I first joined back in 2017 with Jimmy Adams and others. And I've had enormous support throughout the region from particularly the governments as well and the media. So I'm looking forward to the next challenge. It's certainly not been a role that I've achieved everything that I wanted to do. But I guess as I probably reflect more, it's something where, there is no silver bullet, there's no magic wand. So in terms of getting the teams, all of the teams winning consistently, home and away, is not something I've been able to achieve. The governance structure of Cricket West Indies that's been spoken about for decades, again, whilst we've made some progress, certainly not as much as I and others would have wished for. And still in terms of the real funding of grassroots cricket, that's those schools programmes that are critical to the long-term future of cricket in the West Indies. Again, I'll probably underachieve there from a personal perspective, where I set myself always very high standards and ambitious objectives. But look, we're in a much stronger financial position, as everyone would expect, on the back of England and India tours in 22 and 23, and with England coming again in November to the Caribbean, that gives another opportunity to boost the coffers on the back of what's been, again, a successful T20 World Cup. But we need that money. We now budget as a four-year cycle for the business. We're 1 year into that cycle. And we need to end this year in a very good financial position, because we know that 25 and 26 will be difficult before we hope and expect India to come again in 2027. So hopefully I'm leaving the organisation with that different culture and mindset, that you have to budget over a four-year period. When England and India come, you have to make hay while the sun shines. And that allows you then to continue to invest in your cricket systems and your cricket structures, because everyone else in the world is doing it. And if we're not careful, we'll be left behind.
Yeah, well, we're going to delve a little bit deeper into some of what you've just said. But before we do that, I just want to ask you, Johnny, because you held pretty strong administrative roles in cricket prior to coming to the Caribbean in 2017 with the Professional Cricket Association in England and the Surrey Cricket Club as well. Was this job tougher than those previous administrative roles you held in the sport?
Yeah, I think it was. Yeah, definitely. It was the first time, as you said, I'd taken on a CEO role. I'd been a board member and commercial director of the PCA for a decade. And yeah, at times that was enormously challenging. And at Surrey County Cricket Club, obviously the start to my career in sport, and yeah, 24 years now working in cricket. It's probably longer than I expected when I walked through the Hobbs Gate, the Oval Cricket Ground, about 24 years ago. I didn't expect to still be employed in the game, but it's a game that I love. It's a game that I think has enormous potential, not just here in the Caribbean, but throughout the world. And it's definitely been the biggest challenge of my career, without a doubt.
Yeah, Johnny, you know, I've listened to you over the last 5 minutes, like I've listened to you very closely over the last 7 years, and I'm driven to ask you this question. Do you feel that you have more to offer to West Indies cricket?
Well, look, I'm always going to be a fan, and I'm always going to rally, and I want to see the organisation continue to thrive. So I've said to all the staff, I've said to our partners in the Caribbean Premier League, and to anyone that's asked me if they ever need my help or advice in the future, I'm here. But no, I do feel these roles are, and in fact, talking to some other CEOs in world cricket that have either decided to step down or have left, you know, everyone I think reflects and says how exhausting and all-encompassing these roles are, and that at the right time, before you've outstayed your welcome, it's important to hand over, and hopefully someone comes in to replace me and looks at the organisation the way I did back in 2017, and, you know, is laser focused with to make further improvements. You know, I've made some changes, improvement, as I said, with the help of staff and stakeholders, and hopefully the next person that come in can take West Indies cricket at every aspect onto the next level.
Yeah, and I think Lance touched on it to begin this interview, but I just wanted to get a clearer understanding. I know Lance spoke about the one-year extension to your contract at the end of last year, and you spoke about having conversations with the Cricket West Indies president, Kishore Shalu, about when was the right time for you to step away. For Johnny Grave, at what stage did you make that decision that, yes, I am ready for that fresh challenge? I have done all that I need to do at Cricket West Indies, or all that I can do at this stage, or all that I have the energy to do. At what stage of this process did you make that decision?
Look, I think as a family, we decided probably around Easter time that, you know, it was the right time for us to be thinking about moving on. You'll notice, and Lance mentioned my career, I did 7 years at Surrey County Cricket Club, 10 years at the PCA. I liked to sort of see things through. But I also like to make sure that I can leave them and the people that have given me so much support and work with me in the best possible situation. So I wasn't going to just up sticks and go. I wanted to do a smoother handover and professional transition as I can. And the board decided that that would be effectively a one-month extension to my existing contract, and that I could tidy up affairs in the next 3 months. And I've certainly not spent the last few days on the beaches here in Antigua. I've been in the office, and will continue to do everything I can to make sure that I leave my colleagues and friends at Cricket West Indies with the best possible opportunity to continue the work that needs to be done. The day after our leave, England will be here for a big, important tour, and I want that to be a huge success. And I want everyone to continue the work that we started and that strategic plan that was signed off by the board back in March at the AGM. That gives the next person 3 years to deliver on that plan, as well as obviously formulate the next one from 27 to 31. So, it's the right time for me and the board and my family. And, I'm looking forward to the next chapter, but I'm very focused, as I said, about making sure that I hand over professionally and there's a succession to me and the organisation continues to do the important work it needs to do.
Yeah, and you've mentioned the next person quite a bit. You even mentioned earlier an interim CEO. Will you have any say? Have you been asked to make recommendations as to who that next person will be, whether interim or permanent?
No, certainly, look, in terms of the interim, I'd certainly have an opinion on that. We'll give that, as I give all my opinions all the time to anyone on any subject, as you well know. And, I'll do my best to hand over, not just to them, but to all of the heads of departments. And, I'm assuming that the next CEO will join after I've departed, I'm certainly going to be available to them to do as much of a handover remotely if I'm not in the Caribbean, to ensure that they're set up for success. And I'll always be available to, as I said, anyone in Cricket West Indies who wants to pick my brains or seek my advice on any matter long after I've left.
Can you say who the interim CEO will be?
No, I can't. And I generally haven't spoken much to the president since the announcement because I've been too busy on other matters. But I'm sure in time, and again, there's 3 months for the board to, and there's a board meeting set at the end of September. So I'd imagine that towards the end of next month, that decision may or may not be known. It's very much the decision for the board. And as I said, whether I'm consulted or not, I'll definitely give my opinion on that. But we've got a really strong senior management team here, and there's a number of people that could do the role. And I hope that, the board find a suitable successor to me who can really kick on everything I've done and do it far better than I ever did.
Yeah. Johnny, the president of CWI, Dr. Kishore Shallow, in the press release that announced your departure, suggested that the CWI is poised to deliver the new strategic plan and enter in a new era of governance. Are you aware of these new strategic plans? And if so, do you think they are great and are you impressed by them?
Well, we launched a new strategy back in March at the AGM and got very good reports and feedback from all of our shareholder member stakeholders. We did a similar presentation at the CARICOM symposium that Prime Minister Rowley organised in Trinidad on the eve of the T20 World Cup and again got good feedback from that. I think it's a solid, all-encompassing plan. It builds on the successes of the last plan, but also identifies some of the weaknesses that we've not identified, particularly, as I said, at the start of the interview, the governance reform, infrastructure, and those grassroots programs that do need our leadership and guidance and funding. Governance reform has been, I can't remember when the first report came back, but it was decades ago. That's still the holy grail and one that I desperately hope the Cricket West Indies will embrace sooner rather than later.
Yeah, we've had a lot of discussions on this show, Johnny, as it relates to the structure of the global game and specifically to revenue sharing with the big three, India, Australia, England, dominating that, and how nations like the West Indies fit into that overall revenue sharing, or really the fit is at the back end of it. As you end this 7-year tenure, how do you look at where the West Indies is at now that you are leaving in comparison to when you took over? And are you confident enough that as far as the global space is concerned, that there is a move in the right direction, even if we've not been able to convince the ICC to change the way that the global landscape is at this stage?
Well, look, I think there were three things that I and we West Indies cricket spoke about to the world, which was, one, the last cycle, 2016 to 2023, no men's World Cups went outside of those big three nations you mentioned. And obviously, under the leadership of President Skerrett, we were able to lobby the ICC board and win the bid to host that T20 Men's World Cup. And for people that don't know, when you host the World Cup, it's an opportunity not just for you to get governments to invest in infrastructure and facilities and for people to watch some of the best cricket in the world, but it's a sort of unique opportunity to raise a capital injection into your business. So you're talking north of $20 million would have come to Cricket West Indies accounts on the back of hosting that. So clearly, and with the likes of South Africa, Zimbabwe, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, New Zealand, that Pakistan hosting ICC events over the next 4 years in the men's game, we've sort of tackled to a certain extent that first part we identified. The second one was the revenue sharing of ICC profits. And clearly, we haven't won there because that's still not done on an equitable basis, albeit there is more money coming to Cricket West Indies in quantum terms over the next 4 years from ICC, but in percentage terms, it's less. And obviously, the big three are still getting the lion's share of those profitable distributions. The third level was the bilateral cricket model, where home teams keep the revenue when you host teams and you get zero revenue abroad. And again, we've not tackled that, but it's interesting that the leadership of ECB have come out and said that they believe that needs to change, and they're offering a touring fee to Zimbabwe next year. The Australia leadership have come out and said that they think that it needs to be revisited. And even, in fact, the BCCI Honorary Secretary Jay Shah, in an interview yesterday in India, gave similar sentiments that bilateral cricket needs to look at, particularly how you fund test cricket, and talked about the need to have a test fund for those top-tier test-playing nations. So, we not cracked it, but we certainly made some progress. And I think those discussions and public comments now made by the leadership of India, England and Australia give us some hope that there may be some change in the future.
Yeah, I have one more question before you go, Johnny, because we have long heard that governing West Indies cricket is difficult because the team is made up of different countries, whereas, Australia, England, India, everywhere else has one country. Is that a reasonable, based on your experience, is it reasonable to conclude that governing West Indies cricket is more difficult because you have to be presiding over different territories in one space?
Well, I can say that, having worked in the English system, that the national sovereign nation pride of a Barbados, Jamaica, Trinidad, Guyana is stronger, in my opinion, than Surrey County Cricket Club and Yorkshire, that regional county identity or state or province in other parts of the world, is nothing compared to how pride the nations are of the Caribbean, and rightly so. So there is an added uniqueness to it. But at the same time, other international boards have modernised. They've embraced the fact that we're now in an extremely competitive market within sport and within the wider entertainment sphere, that habits are changing, that technology is changing, and that the need to have a skills-based board. You might be a passionate cricket fan who played the game as an amateur and in an amateur world, have come through a political system. But the skills you need in terms of multi-million dollar contracts, in terms of engaging all the different stakeholders, of lobbying and selling the game of cricket, required different skills. And, we are a big business. We're, for the last few years, a 60, 70 million US dollar company. And that needs, in some respects, different skills from the amateur world of cricket, where we came from. So hence why most of the other international top-tier boards have gone down more skills-based boards. They've embraced more independence. And I think, like everything, it's about getting a balance. I absolutely feel we need strong representation on our board from our territorial boards, from the people who are running cricket across our territories. But I also feel we need that balanced, as the Webby report suggests, with a skills-based independent element too. So hopefully it's something that the board will embrace and the shareholder members will vote on and agree to at some point in the not too distant future.
John Agrave, great talking to you here on the SportsMax Zone. We do hope we'll have another chat with you before you officially demit office in October. And it's been great talking to you over the years. We'll talk again soon, I'm sure.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Cheers, guys.
Okay, John Agrave there, who leaves the CEO role of Cricket West Indies in a few months from now. We go to break. The West Indies closing today at 97 for 7 in reply to South Africa's 160 in the second test match being played in Guyana. We'll talk about that and more after the break.